welcome to this Wednesday worship service. It's my pleasure to welcome you all to this service. Please join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, we stand in your presence wherever we are to acknowledge your love and the amazing work of your hand. The treasures of your creation are everywhere to be seen, and we thank you for our very lives. Thank you for the gift of faith, and we ask that you bless your church throughout the world. Thank you for calling us into fellowship with the Holy Spirit and each other. And we pray for our minister, Reverend Makoti, as he encourages and leads your people here. Guard him against despair and temptations in his walk with you, and bring us all back when we wander blindly into the traps of ignorance, doubt, and self-satisfaction. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your grace and mercy, and we pray for those who are sick or struggling with the weight of living in a fallen world. Help us to remember to turn to you, to call on your name, to read your living word and claim your promises. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. We ask you to accept our praise and worship in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The reading this morning is from Genesis chapter 21, verses 8 to 21. And I'm reading from the NIV version. The child grew and was weaned. And on the day Isaac was weaned, Abraham held a great feast. But Sarah saw that the son whom Hagar the Egyptian had borne to Abraham was mocking. And she said to Abraham, "Get rid of that slave woman and her son, for that slave woman's son will never share in the inheritance with my son Isaac." This matter distressed Abraham greatly because it concerned his son. But God said to him, "Do not be so distressed about the boy and your maidservant. Listen to whatever Sarah tells you, because it is through Isaac that your offspring will be reckoned. I will make the son of the maidservant into a nation also, because he is your offspring." Early the next morning, Abraham took some food and a skin of water and gave them to Hagar. He set them on her shoulders and then sent her off with the boy. She went on her way and wandered in the desert of Beersheba. When the water in the skin was gone, she put the boy under one of the bushes. Then she went off and sat down nearby, about a bow shot away, for she thought, "I cannot bear to watch the boy die." And as she sat there nearby, she began to sob. God heard the boy crying, and the angel of God called to Hagar from heaven and said to her, "What is the matter, Hagar? Do not be afraid. God has heard the boy crying as he lies there. Lift the boy up and take him by the hand, for I will make him into a great nation." Then God opened her eyes, and she saw a well of water. So she went and filled the skin with water and gave the boy a drink. God was with the boy as he grew up. He lived in the desert and became an archer. While he was living in the desert of Paran, his mother got a wife for him from Egypt. Thanks be to God for his precious word. I'd like to invite Johnson to come now and give us his message. Thank you, Johnson.
Good morning, church. We want to thank you for giving your time to listen to the word of God. Today is Wednesday during the midweek service, and we want to thank God that we are still able to share the word of God with everyone who is able to listen, not only in our church, but now globally. And we want to thank God for that. Our reading comes from Genesis chapter 21, verses 8 to 21, as Velda has already read the word of God. In Genesis chapter 12, as Abraham is called to uproot himself and his family and set out for a new land to which his God would direct him, it prompted me to come up with a theme: when life doesn't go according to plan. When life doesn't go according to plan. I think everyone has got a plan in his life. Plans of traveling, plans of doing things. A lot of people have cancelled their travelings because they'd planned to go somewhere, but because of the COVID, all these plans were cancelled. So when life doesn't go according to plan, that's my theme. During the course of this, the journey, God makes Abraham some wonderful promises, but they all involved posterity. And by the time we reach chapter 16, we are informed that Abraham and Sarah are still childless, despite being relatively along in years. This was a particular disaster in the ancient world. Since children stabilized that society, they were a supply of labor, a promise of old age security, and guarantors of orderly transfer of property. Indeed, for a woman to fail to give her husband children was seen as a curse from God. Knowing that Abraham was rich, he was rich in everything. He was rich. For Abraham, all these divine promises were on hold. If the journey of 1,000 miles begins with the first step, then the promise of descendants, so numerous as to be compared to stars in the sky and saints by the sea, will begin with the first child. Big problem. There's no child now. There was an alternative, surrogate motherhood. Custom of the day permitted a woman to claim as her own any children a servant girl might bear after a liaison with the master of the house. So by the time Abraham and Sarah addresses this possibility, Sarah was past her childbearing years. She was 90 years old, and Abraham was 100. So according to Genesis record, Sarah and Abraham, you see that the Lord has prevented me from bearing children. Go in to my slave girl. It may be that I shall obtain children by her. And Abraham listened to the voice of Sarai. So after Abraham had lived 10 years in the land of Canaan, Sarai, Abraham's wife, took Hagar, the Egyptian, her slave girl, and gave her to her husband, Abraham, as a wife. He went into Hagar, and she conceived. Now the trouble starts. The Genesis record says, when Hagar saw that she had conceived, she looked with contempt on her mistress. What did she do? Little verbal jabs, eyebrows elevated for a view down the nose, walk around the tent with barely tounding thrust forward? Who knows? Just the meanness of youth sneering at age. How painful it is, learning that the world doesn't operate according to what we believe is fair. It happens to all of us, and it has always been that way. It has happened to us, and it has happened so much, especially this year, 2020, when everything we've planned is not gone according to our programs. We had even, in our church, we've come up with a calendar, everything that we're supposed to be doing. All the things that we're supposed to be doing, we've all canceled those things because it did not work according to our plan. It seems like a good idea at that time, but the things hadn't ever worked as planned. Down through the centuries, marriages, as though they could engage in relationship outside marriage without harmful consequences. Almost 100% of the time, people discover that monogamous relationships are difficult enough, and a complicated marriage tries all but impossible. Sure enough, things become problematic. There's the agreement that they can, the three people can share love, Sarai, Hagar, and Abraham. Yes, it thought it was going to be, or only maybe I discovered that those things works in Africa, where I've seen that my grandfather had two wives. So yes, in a way it was working. They never chased each other, but because both of them had children, maybe that was the reason. When she becomes pregnant, Hagar ceases acting like Sarah's handmaid and begins to act like the queen of the tent. Serious trouble ensues between the two women, and Hagar finds himself out in the street. Things do not go according to plan. The next day now she said, "Go out of my house." She was chased out into the street. It took divine intervention to get her back into the house. An angel of the Lord meets Hagar on the road and tells her to return home. In time, Hagar delivers a son and names him Ishmael. In Genesis 16, things go relatively smoothly until 13 years later, when Sarah conceives and bears a son of her own. This child is named Isaac. Abraham is now the profound father of two sons, one with his wife and one with his wife's maid. So the lesson for today opens about 3 years later at the traditional part of, to celebrate a child's winning. Sarah sees Ishmael, now 16 years old, playing with his little brother. The boys get along very well. Isaac's little eyes sparkle when he sees Ishmael. Ishmael enjoys helping to care for his little brother. Sarah, on the other hand, harbors a deep resentment. The thought that the son of her maid stands to receive the same inheritance as her son outrages her. Now it is true that she was the one who suggested Abraham have a child by Hagar in the first place. But that was before Isaac. Things just are not going according to plan. How many of us have found ourselves in a similar situation? Something seems like a great idea at one point in life and a terrible idea at another time. I suspect many of the young adults currently succumbing to the fate of getting a tattoo will come to know precisely what that means. You get the tattoos all of you over your body when you are young. Then when you grow up again, you want to change, and it's too late. So many decisions made while you impact the rest of our days. Consider the people who are miserable at work. They chose the occupation for reasons which seemed reasonable, but by midlife they changed, or their circumstances changed, and the joy that was once fulfilling is now a burden. Unfortunately, advancement, man and family responsibilities make it unrealistic to change jobs. Career choices can be as permanent as tattoos. Sometimes things just do not work out the way you want. Sarah looks up on Ishmael as a tattoo, the permanent result of a choice she made under different circumstances. She tries for a course correction. She calls Abraham and demands that he get rid of Hagar and Ishmael. Disinherit the boy and send them away, she tells her husband. Furiously, she takes her heart out on her husband. Abraham, it's your fault. When I offered you Hagar, you actually took it. This would never have happened if it were not of you. You men, you are the trouble causer. Face it, chase him, let him go. Abraham is shocked. He loves his son Ishmael. Just because he's another son, Isaac, doesn't mean he loves Ishmael endless. I am reminded of a friend named Job. He was raised by his mother and grandparents. His father, he had been told, abandoned him and his mother when he was an infant. As a young adult, Joe sought out and found his father. He had remarried, was raising a family, and was living in the same city where Joe was attending college. Locating his father was a glorious experience. About the fourth visit, however, his father told Joe they could not see one another. His father explained that his new wife had not known about Joe's existence until he showed up on the doorstep. She was very angry. It was causing problems with his other children. So the wife told Joe's father he could not continue to see his lost son if he expected to keep his marriage happy. He hated to do it, but he felt he had no choice. Abraham finds himself in that same spot. He cares about both his sons as well as his wife, Sarah. It becomes increasingly obvious that circumstances are such that he is not going to be able to have them all together. Sarah will not stand for it. Abraham must have mumbled about the inherited unfairness of life. He loves both his sons, He does not want to have to make a choice between them. Life is not going according to plan. Things are changing. When you see things change in your life, please don't worry, because sometimes life is like that. Then a second divine intervention occurs. God tells Abraham that he should turn Ishmael out of the house as his wife requests. God will not only tend to Ishmael's needs in the wilderness, but Ishmael will also be the father of a great nation. To this day, tradition holds that Ishmael is the father of all Arab people. Consequently, Abraham prepares to send Hagar and Ishmael into the desert. To be perfectly honest, Abraham doesn't provide much for them. He gives Hagar and Ishmael some bread and one goat skin of water. For a trip through the desert, this is not over provisional. So the text is quite fascinating at this point. It says that Abraham puts both the water bag and Ishmael on the shoulder of Hagar and sends them on their way. How curious. Ishmael is 16 years old and he rides off on his mother's shoulders. So the scripture must mean that metaphorically, Hagar must have felt like she was carrying her son on her shoulders. That makes more sense. In fact, are they not parents who feel as though they carry on their grown on or on their grown children on their shoulders? Sometimes it happens like that. Don't you wonder sometimes if they will never grow up? Don't you wonder sometimes if they ever stop coming home in times of trouble? It is the same from the perspective of Ishmael. Are they not 16-year-olds who feel as though someone else must carry them if they are never going to make it? We don't plan for life to turn out that way. But life doesn't always go according to our plan. Hagar and Ishmael wander south of the wilderness near Beersheba. They exhaust the food and water supply. The strength of the teenager Ishmael fails first. His mother puts him under a bush out of the blazing desert sun. As the boy sinks towards death, his mother sits down about 50 yards away and waits for the inevitable to happen. It is a scene as sad as those who see it on the evening news. A famine in the land. A starving child waits to die. A mother sits nearby, her head hung in helpless and desperate. Then Ishmael murmurs. God hears his crying. For the third time, this story, the divine intervention comes in. Hagar opens her eyes and sees what seemed to be an oasis. Could it be a mirage? Perhaps. But wealthy palm trees in the desert stand out against the stark desert background. How could they be palm trees? Hagar gathers all her strength and goes to see. Sure enough, it's a source of water. She fills the goat skin and takes it back to Ishmael. The water smacks his thirst. He pinched his lips and healed. He regains his strength. This particular story ends by saying they continue to live in the wilderness. Ishmael becomes an expert archer. His mother finds him a wife from among the Egyptians who travel through the area. There is a tendency simply to conclude by saying, and they lived happily after Eve. We might even want to say things may not have worked according to the people's plan, but they worked out according to God's plan. And that is even better. Frankly, that would miss the point if it works according to our plan. At several junctures, in the story, God intervenes. Frankly, that doesn't solve everything. Sarah wanted her husband to have a son. He encouraged him to have one by the maid. God gave her the gift of a son, but she is resentful and bitter. Abraham loved both his sons. He wanted to raise them both. When that plan didn't work out, God promised to take care of Ishmael and to make him the father of another great nation. But Abraham still feels guilty about sending Ishmael away. That boy was his own flesh and blood. Every time Ishmael came to mind, a pain shot through the heart of Abraham. Think about it. You can't go to sleep when you know that your own son is wandering in the desert. No one to look after. And do you think for a moment that Hagar and Ishmael were totally pleased with the way things turned out? Abraham had promised Ishmael half the family inheritance. They lost that and the life they had known. In essence, they lived out their days in the desert. Even when God intervenes, life does not always go according to plan. It works in the opposite. Life is not always fair. I have seen, I have talked to my children, sometimes you hear them, it's not fair. And I always say, yes, it's not fair. Life is not always fair. An expectation that it will be otherwise are met with a disappointment. We must come to terms with that. Life simply does not come with a fairness guarantee, nor with assurance that everything will work out. Life is not fair. Talk to anyone who is working. They will say things are not fair at their workplace. Things are not fair. Yes, they are not fair, but that is what it is. Life is not fair. We have plans about what we want to accomplish, what we want to accumulate, what we want to go. We may or may not attain those things. But even if we do, in the end, we discover it's not all important that we do. It's not all important. So the story is told about a Sunday school class in which a particularly effective teacher was relating the story of Abraham taking his son Isaac off into the wilderness to sacrifice him. The teacher told the story so well that one child covered his ears and said, "This scares me. I don't want to listen to it." Another child reassured him, "Don't worry. This is one of God's stories and they always turn out to be right." Isn't that the point? You are one of God's stories and things will turn out all right. You are one of God's stories. Just by you, just your image, just who you are God's story. You may think people hate you. You may think people don't love you. You may think maybe you are created to suffer. No, you are not. You are one of God's stories. Things will always work right in your life if you listen to what God wants. Every committed Christian was desperately ill. She spoke about a recent visit she had with her aged and equally ill brother. She realized that this would probably be the last time they would see one another before his or her death. So in recent years, she said, "I've noted it. Doesn't really matter whether we get together a fine family reunion for a said funeral. Both events feel the same. It is not the occasion that makes the day. It is the loving relationship we have. Therefore, a funeral feels the same as a party." Sometimes when you are wondering to say some people at a funeral will be mourning, crying. But again, at that funeral, it becomes a get-together because all family members come and you support each other. And when you are here celebrating Christmas, all members of the family came together and we support each other. So it becomes a party as well. So that is the bottom line. What makes life go according to plan? It is accumulating wealth, achieving worldly success, getting our way, our own way. Not, of course not. What makes life worth are the loving relationships we make with God and one another. That is what makes life matter. When we make this relationship close with our friends and loving God and love one another, everything else pales by comparison. This is the thing that makes a difference. You are one of God's stories. And no matter how badly things seem to be going, you will turn out all right. Life may be unfair. Things may not go according to your plan. But you are God's story. There is something God wants you to achieve at the end. There is something God wants you to learn. No matter how many blessings God gives you, life may seem to come up short. You are one of God's stories and you don't have to worry about anything because it will turn out all right. You are one of God's stories. As you are listening to me, you are one of God's stories. If you relate your story to other people, it can tell them, it can tune them to discomfort. They may not believe what you are saying. But that is the story that you are relating. Meaning that God is in control of your life. God is pushing you somewhere. Continue in your relationship with God. Listen to God's voice. Even when you think things are not fair, listen to God's voice. God is always there. Either to comfort you, to support you, to help you. And I know that because God is always there, you'll always be on the victory side. Because that's what God intends. Think about it. Think about it. Think about your life. It's a journey. Look back where you've come from. Your experiences in life. Think about your experiences, where you have been, and you'll see the hand of God upon your life. That is exactly what I'm talking about. The hand of God is always upon your life. May the good Lord bless you as you live, as you ponder upon these words, as you think deeply, as you meditate, that life may not always is unfair. That life is always unfair to others. But when you talk about those things, just realize that God's hand is upon your life. God bless you. In Jesus' name, amen. Let us pray. My Father, I thank you for this day and breath of life in Jesus' name. Lord, have mercy on us. Forgive us our sins. Lord, you are our God. Lead us in the path you want us to go. Guide us, Lord. Sometimes we see things not in the way you see them. Sometimes we see the unfairness of things when it is really a promotion from you. Father, we cry to you this day. Let our cry be heard by you in Jesus Christ. Father, arise and visit our destiny so we can receive divine transformation, divine guidance, divine promotion. Fill us, Lord, with the living water and put up to an end and thirst in our lives. We may be thirsty for different things. We may be hungry for different things. Just put that to an end, Father. Lord Jesus Christ, you are our companion in this journey. Even in the wilderness, in the desert of life, you are there with us. You have shown it that you were able to be there with Ishmael. Not only with Ishmael, but with so many people who had followed you. Thank you, Father, for your continuous support, caring, and love. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all from now and evermore. Amen.